Good morning, church. Praise the Lord. We can be in God's house today on Mother's Day, Sunday. Beautiful day. It's not raining yet, but we've been praying for rain. Amen. And so I hope it does rain. I'm glad you can make it to church. Take your blue songbook and turn to page 44, and let's make a joyful noise. Let's all stand. From the road. And so really it's a legal matter. I really think it's a bunch of nonsense, but there is people that still feel like they want to be 6 foot, so we got to honor it. And, you know, some people are afraid of getting sick, so we got to honor people's feelings. If they feel like the right virus is still around, there is a virus around. It's the flu. Amen. And so we don't want know, people don't want to catch it, and I understand that. And lots of people die every year from the virus, but let's just pray for the families of those. And as far as I know, not yet that anybody in our church or their families have got the coronavirus. Is that so? Is anybody going in our church? We pray that God would protect us from it. So I believe he has. Amen. And so I'm not worried about it. I really think God, when it's your time to go, you're going to go no matter how it be. It might be on the way home today. Amen. So we just know that when we do leave this earth, the most important thing is that we know him and that we're close to him. But you pray for some that are hurting. Miss Val, you pray for her. Her husband Tom went home to be with the Lord, and really it's a grateful thing to me. I mean, I'm really thinking what Tom's doing right now and the joys of me, but he wasn't my husband, amen. So I feel sorry for her that she's had the part this time, even though she knows where he's at. Pray for her, because it hurts when you lose people and you can't see them no more. You can't wake up and be with them every day, and it's new to her. So you pray that God would give her strength to keep his eyes on her. I mean, a lot of things happen, and he said he won't put on us more than we can handle. But anybody remember Ann that used to come here, piano player, that had called yesterday, and I guess her husband or fiance's sister died. And so they're asking for prayer for the family there. And then, of course, there's a lot of people in our church hurting. I appreciate Miss Wanda being here today, but she's still trying to get over that accident she had. And I told her, don't be picking up heavy stuff no more. Hey, call us. We'll come over and pick it up for you. And so I'm glad she's feeling good enough to come to church today. So praise the Lord for that. And you just pray that God would continue to work in the people of our church. You know, we want to see our church grow. We want to see things happen in this time. And we want to see people turn to God. I'm going to tell you, something great's going to have to happen to get this country to turn back to God. So only God can do it. I think only God can make things happen as far as where revival can come back again. I know God's already poured his spirit out on this earth, and we've seen great revivals happen in the past. I've been involved with some of them. But the great ones, you know, of the pouring out of God's spirit has happened, but God can still do this. But how many people really want revival? How many people, this is the question, how many Christians really want revival to happen? Would they come to church every day if they could? Would people do that? You know, you just don't see that no more. And so listen, God's looking, he's seeing, he's wondering how many people are on their knees. But today's Mother's Day, and we appreciate the mothers. How many mothers we got in here today? Amen. God, praise the Lord. Not that many, but you know what? You're here. Usually Mother's Day, we're swelled up, but you know, people are still afraid that we got the coronavirus today to keep people out of church. We got the rain to keep people out of church. And then I think some people just want a good reason not to come to church. I don't know, but I'm glad that you're here today. I'm glad you're here. It's good to see faces. Amen. And I don't have to talk to that phone. That phone makes me nervous. Amen. When it's just me and the phone, I get nervous. I think, why is this phone making me nervous? Look what these people have done to me. But we do have something today. And don't worry, I didn't kiss these or lick them or anything like that. We're going to put these at the door so you're not going to get any cooties off of them. And it's a gift for the ladies. And it has a nice pen in it. What it is, it's a notebook for you to put down your prayer requests, your sermon notes, and things for you to do. It's very nice. And so we're going to put this by the door. And being that there's not very many of you here today, we're going to give one of these to every lady in the house, okay? So you don't have to be a mother. Then all the mothers get one of these magnets. You stick on your refrigerator, and it gives some faith and hope and strong and courageous for you. So all the mothers, this will be right in the middle. Take one of these on the way out for your Mother's Day gift. We didn't get nothing real special today. We like going around and doing a drawing, but we'd be breaking the social distancing rules if we did that. So we're not allowed to do that. Isn't it something, man, they can control the whole world? Somebody's sitting over and they got everybody doing all this stuff. And I'm going to tell you now, I've seen so many things that are contrary, and there's so much going on, and I'm getting stuff from preachers now. This isn't just stuff I'm seeing on Google. As a matter of fact, you get off Google, there's a lot of other websites you can get on and find out true news. And so I want truth. Don't you want the truth? Don't you hate when people beat around the bush? I want to hear the truth, amen. I want to know what's going on, and you know what? We get the truth from God's word, And see, God's the only one that can reveal the truth. And so if we want the truth to come out, we got to pray for the truth. And so, Christians, you pray today. Isn't he good? He's good to us all the time, churches. So we got to continue. We do have a face mask back there if you want to wear one. I see there's a couple people got them on. Some of y'all are thinking we're just wearing them for a novelty. And we have a lot of Johns in our church. Amen? But listen, I'm glad you don't wear them because I can read lips and I can't tell when you're talking about me if you got a face mask on. Amen? And so listen, we do have them even for novelty if you want to take one home and stick it on the wall so you can remember the coronavirus 5 years from now. Maybe or something to show your kids if we're still here. But church, I think time's at hand. You know what? People in the world, they really can't tell what's going on, but we can see. Can you see? Can you see what's going on? Everything's being put into place. Everything that's happening in Israel, and all the things that are happening, including to what's going on with the leaders of our country, what's happening in America, it's all coming to the return of Christ. And we're seeing it happen. I'm ready. You ready to meet him this morning? And I'm ready to go home. And you know, I just want to take as many people as I can with me. How about you this morning? Hey, you ready? I'll tell you what, as soon as they open the country back up, we're going to go back full swing of what we do. I know some people's asked, so that's what we're going to do. We're going to go right back to going out visiting and doing our thing that we do. And, you know, if people don't want to, we'll knock on their door and we'll step back 6 feet. Amen. And so we'll still be there. But people need to know about God. You know, there's so many people still in our country that just don't know nothing. They watch TV, they've been modified to sit in front of that tube and be brainwashed. And so, you know what? They've brainwashed our entire country with the internet and with the television. And so people need to get away from that. It'd be nice if we did lose the TVs for a while. I wish they would all crash. I wish I had a zapper that I could just hit and burn up everybody's TV in one shot. And the whole country would go nuts, amen? Walmart would be going crazy selling TVs. I heard a preacher say one time, be glad I'm not God. Because if I was God, there'd be grease spots everywhere on this planet. And so, you know what? Our God's a God of mercy. Aren't you glad he's merciful? And he's a merciful God. Turn to page 560 with me this morning. 560, and let's all stand and make a joyful noise. We got some more coming in, Mother's Day. 560. Let's go. Thank you. It's a joyful song for us. Y'all turn to page 411. I miss that little time when we get to go around and greet each other. And, you know, I'm hoping that time comes back real soon. You know, we can go up and actually and not have to worry about people and what they think or what they're doing. And, you know, worry about sickness and health. One day we're going to be there. Page 411, sing this with us. Sing in front of anybody before. It's really one of the first songs I learned when I became a Christian and started playing again. And my former pastor, who's gone home to be with the Lord, used to sing this song in church. And I heard it one time and it touched me, and so I learned the song a long, long time ago. And so I'm going to try to pray, sing it for you this morning. So listen to the words of this song. It's about a 25-year-old song, but it's really got a good message. Everything he He's wondering why I have so much faith. And I said, man, it comes from the Spirit of God. You know, I explained to him, I said, you can't know it. I see, just as you're acting, it's foolishness on the unbelief. You can't have it unless you have the Spirit. You know, so he took that, and we can explain things to people, but you know, there's so many people in the world that don't know God. They don't understand what we can feel and that we can praise and we can sing praise to Him with feeling from our heart because I have Him. You don't understand, He's inside of me. And I told Him this, I pray for you every single day. And this is the thing, I believe God's going to draw you. He obviously hasn't yet. So when He does, you better run to Him, man, because time's running out. And so I believe the Spirit of God's still working. He's still working in us, amen? Do you believe that this morning? If you have your Bibles this morning, turn with me to the book of Exodus. You know, I was looking through, and I preached quite a few Mother's Day messages. I think I've preached on every woman in the Bible, actually. And I got to this one, and I thought, you know, this is it. The Lord set me right here. And we're gonna preach on Jochebed this morning. And so if you don't know who that is, it really don't have the scriptures in the story. But we're going to read a little bit of the story this morning. to head us up to what she did and her faithfulness to God. Look, we have to have faith in God if we're going to believe God's going to do anything. Do you believe God this morning? Amen. You know, hey, how many of us in here could use some more faith? Amen. And hey, don't we all? We all need it. We need some more. And so hopefully we'll get some of that this morning. But let's read the story. It's not that long. We're going to read part of chapter 1 and go into chapter 2 a little bit. We'll start in Exodus chapter 1. Of course, we all know the story. They were being afflicted. They were in Egypt. And we'll start in verse 12. It says, "But the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew. And they were grieved because of the children of Israel." You know, sometimes Christians around the world, we grieve the people that aren't Christians. They don't like us. They don't like what we believe. They don't like what we think. They're constantly trying to put us down. But yet we have prospered and prospered. You realize in the world today, God has done many great things with Christians in the world. But listen, and the Egyptians made the children of Israel to serve with rigor. And they made their lives bitter with hard bondage and mortaring and bricking and all manner of service in the field, and all their service with wherein they made them serve was with rigor. And it says, "And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of the one was Asherah, and it says, and the name of the other was Puah. And it says, and she, he said, when ye do the office of the midwife to the Hebrew women and see them upon the stools, if it be a son, then ye shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live." But the midwives feared God. Amen. You know what's the problem with the world today? They don't fear God. The midwives feared God, even though they didn't know God. They knew that the Israelites knew God. And it says, "And did not as the king of the Egyptians commanded them, but saved the men children alive. And the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said unto them, Why have you done this thing? And have saved the men children alive. And the midwives said unto Pharaoh, Because the Hebrew women are not as the Egyptian women, for they are lively and are delivered ere the midwives come in unto them." That means they're having the babies before they ever get there. And listen, "Therefore God dealt well with the midwives, because they obeyed God, not man." Listen, "And the people multiplied and waxed very mightily. And it says, and it came to pass, because the midwives feared God, that he made them houses." God, you know, he helps our faithfulness to him. But it says, "And Pharaoh charged all his people." And so the midwives aren't going to do the job. Now he's telling all the people that aren't of the Israelites, "Every son that is born, ye shall cast into the river, and every daughter ye shall save alive." Now you think today, as we live and we get through this story, this really happened. Do you believe this really happened? Amen. This is the word of God. I believe it really happened. I believe all of it. Amen. And I believe that they were here and they were stuck in this circumstance today. And there was power being brought over them. The whole world was against them now. And now they want them to kill their children. And so listen, let's read on in chapter 2. It says, "And there went a man of the house of Levi and took a wife, a daughter of Levi. And the woman conceived and bare a son, and when she saw him that he was a goodly child, she hid him 3 months. And when she could not longer hide him, she took for him an ark of bulrush, and dabbed it with slime and with pitch, and put the child therein. And she laid it in the flags by the river brink. And his sister stood afar off to wit what would be done to him. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maidens walked along the riverside. And when she saw the ark among the flags, she went, sent her maid to fetch it. And when she had opened it, she saw the child, and opened, and behold, the babe wept. And she had compassion on him, and said, This is one of the Hebrew children. And she said, Then said the sister of Pharaoh's daughter, Shall I go and call thee a nurse of the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for thee? And Pharaoh's daughter said, said to her, Go. And the maid went, and the child, they called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, Take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee wages. And the woman took the child and nursed it. Let's pray this morning. Lord, we love you and thank you, God, for your mercy and grace, Lord. And I know, Lord, you know we're but flesh. And Lord, we're here today, Lord, the ones who showed up, they've come to hear from you, Lord. I pray you would use me as your mouthpiece, so you would bless the message, Lord. I bless every mother in this country, Lord, but I pray, God, that you would save souls, that people would come to you, people would hear your word, Lord. You convict, Lord. You would do the drawing as your word says, Lord, and we'll give you the glory. Thank you, God, for your mercy and grace. Please bless this message this morning in the precious name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. As we look at this morning, I titled this message, A Mother with a Plan in Trying Times. You know, we're living in some trying times. This is really crazy times we're living in. And people of the faith that know what's going on in the Bible, people that don't know the Bible or know anything about God, they're thinking, well, this happened before. You know, they did something like this when the swine flu was here. They did something back in the 1900s when some others were here, but never to the extent to cause and affect the entire world. And so, you know, the entire world's being affected now by this. So as we look at this, you think of how they're being affected and what she did. And Jochebed was a faithful mother, and so she believed God. But let's read the scriptures and see what the Lord laid on my heart. It says, and there went a man and a woman of the house of Levi and took a wife, the daughter of Levi. And so, you know, God told us to be faithful and multiply. And so it really doesn't matter. He doesn't say when or when you're under suppression to stop doing that. We're supposed to multiply and be together. But I'm going to give you a first point. She continued on even in trying times. And so listen, we have to continue. Our faith has to continue. Hey, our voice has to continue for God, even in trying times. And I'm going to tell you, we're living in trying times. And I really don't think we've seen nothing yet. I speak that we are in the beginning of sorrows. I think that what the Bible teaches, and so listen, as sorrow comes to this world, a child of God just keeps looking back to the Word of God. And we see as these things come in, and they start happening to us, and he said they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you. Well, we haven't suffered anything in America. I mean, you know, they suppressed us from talking about God at football games and, you know, trying to kick God out of everything, out of our schools, which we got back in. Praise the Lord. You know, we got that back in there. But listen, we're seeing things that were going on now, which is the beginning of sorrows with what's going on in the world. They're changing our whole way of life. Yeah, I can't stand it. I can't come within 6 foot. And really, I'm going to tell you, it's real hard for me to do that. I have to back up and be thinking about it to not do it. And I'm not going to do it for long. So, you know, listen, we'll have to just start having church out of the parking lot or something. And we'll hoot and holler and start having things like how Ralph Sexton's been doing for his. But listen, because of her faith, she believed God more than the situation that they were in. As she believed what God was doing, as she believed that what she was supposed to do, and listen, we got, the Word of God tells us in Romans 8:18, it tells us that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory that should be revealed in us. And so as we think of what's going on, we must continue on. Hey, Randy and Emma had a baby. They were kind of concerned about people keeping social distancing. They don't want really nobody. They don't want their baby to catch the coronavirus. I don't blame them. There is a virus out there. It's real. But I believe some things have been done to the virus and made it worse. And so, but you know, they have a beautiful baby. It was in the hospital last week. If you watched the message Wednesday night, it was it had hypoxia. And so they brought it in here, but listen what happened. He sent me a text when he was going to the hospital. I think he sent me one before he sent his mama one because they were texting and she didn't know what was going on. And so listen, he was in the hospital. They got in there. Baby wasn't breathing right. Wasn't getting enough air. And then all of a sudden she got better. I said, well, did that shock you, man? And did that make you something? He said, the doctors said they don't know what happened to her. They don't know why it went away, or they don't know anything. I said, did you tell them why? And because we prayed for her, all of a sudden she was better, ready to go home. So she got checked out and back home. And so they're worried about their daughter, but they have a baby in times like this. But listen, as they looked at their baby, and how many of you ladies in here today? How many mamas are in here again? Praise the Lord. Let me see. Well, we're usually loaded up with them. We got about 10 mamas in here this morning. And when you looked at your baby, your first one, you thought it was the prettiest baby in the world, didn't you? And she said right here, that it says in verse 2, and the woman conceived and bare a son, and when she saw him, that he was a goodly child. You know, when everybody looks and they think, man, I got the prettiest baby in the world. They could have a comb head, you know, whatever, but I got the prettiest baby in the world. And so listen, the Bible actually backs up her statement. In Acts chapter 7 and verse 20, it says that Moses was exceedingly fair. You understand? This baby was beautiful. And so you know what it did? God made that baby beautiful for a reason, because it works into play here in just a little bit down the road in the story. But the child was a gift from God, and she knew, but she had a little time with him. You know, before she was found out. You know, I took this morning. You know, sometimes we don't get to spend a lot of time with people. Some people have a baby, and it goes home to be with the Lord. And, of course, as a man of God, I'm thinking about God. Is that when you lose a baby, if you can think on it this way, it is immediately with Christ. And so the baby didn't have to suffer the things of the world, go through all the things. And I know it's alive, and you wonder why did it happen, but maybe God wanted that soul to be in glory. And so this is, I thought about, and she had her husband for 3.5 years. So I'm going to tell you what you do, is you treasure the time you have with the people you love. You treasure it because it can be gone tomorrow. They can go home with Jesus tomorrow. And even though we know where they're going, it still hurts to lose them. And so, you know what, she knows her time is, and she nurtured, and she knew it was time. You know, this life's a vapor, appears for a little time and vanishes away, and I wish people would grab a hold of that. What it means is we don't have much time here. We don't know what tomorrow brings forth. And you know what, I've had the privilege, and I call it a privilege, to lose my health, and then my health come back. And so I know what it's like not to have health. And man, praise the Lord for health. You know, I'm happy when I'm feeling good. When I get up in the morning and I feel great, isn't it good, praise God, to feel good? Because man, when you don't feel good and our health gets down and things start happening to us, it's hard to deal with life sometimes. But listen, as we go through the scriptures today, remember to treasure your children. Treasure them. I don't care what they're going through. If they're in trouble, pray for them. Hey, they've got people going on and maybe got things happening in their life, but God can still bring them through this. And we want to see people together. We want to see families together, families loving one another in this day and time that we're living in. Because, you know, the Bible says that in the last days, the hearts of many will wax gross and their ears will become dull of hearing. And you know what? And there's going to be people turning and families turning from one another, but not Christian families shouldn't be. We should be leading and guiding through words of God, the Word of God. But secondly, this morning, look at verse 3 with me. It says, and when she could not longer hide him, she took for him an ark of bulrushes and dabbed it with slime, and with pitch and put the child therein, and she laid it in the flags by the river brink. And I got to thinking on this, and I gave a second point that she did all she could to protect him and trusted God with the rest. And ladies, sometimes that's what you got to do. I mean, you do all you can to protect your children, but to the point, sometimes they got to go. It's their life, just like the prodigal son, and they got to make their own choices. And so after that, you just got to trust God. Raise up a child in the ways he will go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. So if he knows it, even if he goes away, he'll come back to God. And so it's something, as a mother, it's our job to do. Praise the Lord, God gave me a Christian wife, and she loves the Lord. She reads her Bible, she studies and teaches her children. We both teach them scriptures, and we try to train them and to being a soldier for Christ. And so it's all we can do, but I can tell you, I want God to use me. I want God to use you. Listen, it says in Exodus 14:14, you remember when Israel was trapped at the Red Sea and Moses told the people, the Lord shall fight for you and ye shall hold your peace. You know what? God is still working. He's working on people, and sometimes there's prodigal sons in many of our families, but God's still working. And you know what? You've got to let God work. You got to let him do what he's doing. And let me read something to you. This story, or portion of this story, is recorded in Hebrews chapter 12 or 11. And let me read that portion to you. Hebrews chapter 11, it says in verse 23, by faith Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents because they saw he was a proper child. It says a godly child, and they were not afraid of the king's commandments. Let me tell you, today, we can't fear. I mean, we're not supposed to fear. The spirit of fear isn't coming from God. See, the devil can get you afraid and get you scared. He can defeat you. You can't win the battle. So this is where our faith comes in. That's why I ask you before church, do you want more faith? I do. I'm asking the Lord daily to increase my faith. I want to be closer. I want revival in my heart. I want to be closer to God every day. I want to see things happen for his honor and glory. And I want to be exactly where he wants me to be. If it's in the middle of China, I mean, that's where I want to be. I want to be exactly where God wants me to be. But she made him an ark. It's something that affords protection and safety. You know, which was probably copied up the Ark of the Covenant. I really thought on this, and many people think different things, but the Ark of the Covenant was about 3'9", and it was made, you know, pretty good size for a baby. And then it had a lid on it. And the lid was the mercy seat. And I think this, she made an ark, she put a lid on it, and you know what? God showed his mercy through this child. You believe God's still showing mercy today? I'm going to tell you what, it's the only reason, church, we can still stand in this church today or sit or where we're being here is because of God's mercy. You know, God gets tired of things going on in this country. And I'm going to tell you what, he's tired of the Laodicean church age, and we're living in it. I believe God, they say, well, why would God do that? Because he's tired of it. I think, you know, he hasn't poured no wrath down on us. I believe God's extending mercy today. But we still have freedoms today. Aren't you glad? Because they could be gone tomorrow. You say, how can that happen? Hey, man, you turn off the power in this country just for a couple of days and see where we're at. And there won't be no freedom. It'll be a chaotic third world country status, and it'll be a mess. But God's still extending mercy today, and I believe that he's still sheltering his children. But she did what she could. She put him in this, and this is representing also the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat represents the presence of God. And so I'm sure she had that heart. She prayed for her child. You can imagine as she was sticking her child in the reeds, what it must have been like to leave your baby. Could you imagine taking that baby and sticking in a little bulrush thing and leaving it in the reeds and having to walk away? Could you imagine? It just couldn't fathom your mind. You know, I think I'd be standing off with a couple of guns, but they didn't have them back then, amen? And I'd tell people, you know, I'm going to go there, amen? I'm being recorded. No, I got to behave myself. Now listen, we got to really understand the presence of God was with Moses. And listen, if you're born again, just think of this. The presence of God is with you. If you're a child of God, the presence of God is with you. He sees everywhere you walk, everywhere you go. Hey, he's protecting you. He's saving you. Can you think how many close calls you've been in your life and that you made it through and it was miraculous? And can you think of that? Wow, God's merciful. And his presence is with us. So really, maybe her timing being off a little bit, she did obey God and man. She might not have threw him in the river, but she put him in there. And then she obeyed God. She didn't kill her baby. But listen, church, I believe God really works in different ways. And I believe God can control any man, any place, any time. And so I believe God's doing that today. And we're going to see some things here in the near future from it. But if you look at this with me, in verse 3 again, it says that when she could not no longer hide him, she took for him an ark of bulrushes and dabbed it with slime and with pitch and put the child therein, and she laid it in the flag by the river bank. The third point I have for you this morning is they trusted God and he directed them. You know, when you believe God, he directs our path. I mean, one of the most famous scriptures in the Bible, even many lost people, because it's been quoted so many times, know it, Proverbs chapter 3, trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. If you think about that, sometimes that's very hard to do. And sometimes it's hard to let God direct us. And so we have a weakness. We are but flesh, and sometimes we direct ourselves. And then our flesh comes out. And people see things in us. I told somebody yesterday when I was witnessing to him, talking to him about the Lord, I said, you know, he knows some things in my past and some things I've done. I said, there's not one idol in the Bible that didn't mess up. See, you got to quit looking at my past and look at your own. And this is the thing. You better start looking at your future, because without Jesus, you don't have one. I got a future. I know where I'm going, and I ain't touching nobody. You know what I'm doing? I'm looking on to Jesus, the author and finisher of my faith. Amen? I'm looking to where I'm going, what I got. And praise God, I got glory this morning. Do you have glory this morning? And do you know where you're going? Because, man, that's all that's going to matter. One day it's coming. He's going to return in the clouds just like he said, church, and call us out of here. And I'm waiting for it. It can happen any moment. I believe that everything is past for him to come. I long for my family to be saved, but I long for Jesus. You know, my second prayer every morning after I get through praising him is I say, Lord, that kingdom come. And thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I'm ready for him to come back. I want to see his face. I want to go be in glory. How about you this morning? Just believe that God put it in the hearts to place him exactly where she did. And I believe God can direct. And I don't know if she knew exactly where they were going to be walking by or what time, but it doesn't give us that much information. But I believe that she stuck the child in the reeds and just prayed. And did you believe this could happen? And then Pharaoh's daughter came along with her maid and saw it. And so you believe God made that appointment? God made that appointment. And so listen, all the mother did was be faithful. And so to your children today, maybe we need to build a heart around some of them with prayer. You know, maybe we need to just hold them up to Jesus in this time we're living in. But this baby was a picture of Christ. You understand? His coming into the world to deliver his people. God sent Moses there, and it's a whole picture of Jesus coming back and delivering his people, right from coming and dying on the cross. And God takes care of the outcast of Israel. Study your Bible. We believe you're supposed to pray for Israel every day. We do this too. And you know what? All those that fear him, God is going to take care of. Do you believe that this morning? Do you fear God this morning? Hey, you're in church. Praise God on Mother's Day, and it's supposed to rain. We haven't gotten done yet, but I believe most of you are preaching to the choir this morning. But let me read a few scriptures to you in Psalms 147 this morning. Maybe encourage you on this. In Psalms 147 and verse 1, it says this. This morning, and these scriptures were encouraged to me. It says, "Praise ye the Lord, for it is good to sing praises unto our God, for it is pleasant, and praise is comely." You know what that means? It's appropriate. It's appropriate for you to sing. You say, "Well, I can't sing." Well, just make a joyful noise, man. Nobody can hear you anywhere. Everybody around you singing. And man, don't stand there. Just sing for God. It's appropriate to praise him. It said, "The Lord doth build up Jerusalem. He gathereth together the outcast of Israel. He healeth the broken in heart and bindeth up their wounds. He telleth the number of the stars. He calleth them all by their names. Great is the Lord and great of great power. His understanding is infinite." You know, when I was witnessing to this lawyer yesterday, and he knows a lot, but he don't know everything. And listen, he told me, "Man, do you know how many planets are out there and how many stars and all this stuff they're around?" I said, "Well, no, I don't think anybody knows but God. But yeah, I know there's a bunch of them because he got on the extraterrestrial life. You don't believe there is?" I said there could be if God put it there, yeah. And so he knows my face on here. I said, "This is what I know. This is what scientists have found out. That there's so many stars in the sky that every person on earth can own 2 trillion of them." And he started laughing. I said, "Look, but before you get done with that, listen, God numbered them and named them all." Amen. That's the God we serve. Amen. You believe that? You believe that, do not? Hey, we could be $26 trillion in debt, but our God's still ahead of the game. Amen. And there's more stars. Listen, "The Lord lifted up the meek. He casteth the wicked down to the ground. Sing unto the Lord with thanksgiving. Sing praise upon the harp unto our God. Who covereth the heaven with clouds, who prepareth rain for the earth, who maketh grass to grow upon the mountains. He giveth to the beast his food, and to the young ravens which cry. He delighteth not in the strength of the horses, and he taketh not pleasure in the legs of man." See, he can care less what we can do. Listen to what the Lord says in verse 11. "The Lord taketh pleasure in them that fear him." You understand? "And those that hope in his mercy." This is what we need in our country today. We need some people that fear God. And they stand up, they believe his word, and do what he says. And we see that if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves. Isn't that the big one? That's the big one right there. People got a hard time with humility. "And pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked way. Then I shall hear from heaven, forgive their sins and heal their land." How about that this morning? Is it something good to you? Is this something that excites you? It should. Listen, look at verse 4 with me. It says, "For his sister stood afar off to wit what be done to him." Now, if you study this out, they believe that that he sent Miriam to go watch and see. And you say, "Well, maybe that shows a lack of faith." But let me tell you something. Viewing a miracle increases my faith. How about you? When you see something really happen, a miracle happen. When I see somebody get saved, to me, it's a miracle. I was a miracle. And when I got saved, I was a miracle. I was the guy that was least likely to get saved. If they would have took the yearbook from high school and dumped out the guy in there that was least likely, it was me. But God saved me. And when people see me today and they ask me what I was doing from high school, they go, "What? You're a preacher?" I say, "Yeah, praise the Lord. I'm a preacher, amen." And you know what? I'm born again child of God. I know where I'm going. Do you know? Because, man, we're all going somewhere. But fourthly, my fourth point is seeing the providence of God in action increases our faith. When we see God do things and work in people and make things happen around us, it increases our faith. It makes us stronger in the Lord. I don't know about you, but I want more faith. I want to be stronger. Pray God. He recorded this in detail for us. And I believe it's work. And I believe it's forever settled in heaven. You believe that this morning? Hey, listen. You can say that this being led by faith and, you know, putting the child in the river, you know, we watch God do what he did and send Pharaoh over to the child. I believe it was an act of God. And God saved the child out of the river. But not only this, God rewards us for our faithfulness. Look at verse 5. It says, "And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maidens walked along the riverside, and when she saw the ark among the flags, she sent her maid to fetch it. And when she had opened it, she saw the child, and behold, the babe wept. And she had compassion on him and said, 'This is one of the Hebrew children.'" Let me tell you, when she came over there, not only did we read about the child being exceedingly fair, so he was a beautiful baby. How could you take a beautiful baby and throw it in the river? I mean, how could you take a beautiful dog and throw it in the river? And so she gets there, and then let me tell you, I believe God made Moses cry right at the right time. I mean, he touched her heart, and she wanted that baby. Who do you think stuck that in her heart? Her daddy said to throw the baby in the river, and she broke her daddy's law, and she got Moses, praise God. But not only that, look what she did. You know, listen, I believe God makes things work at the right time, the right place. Things have happened in our life, and God sends people to us. But do you believe God's still in control this morning? Do you believe it? You believe he's got this? And like Marion, can you see it? Can you see God being in control? You know, I've been watching what's been happening in the political world and what's been happening around this country and some of the high power and the money of our country, the people, the money of the world. I mean, it drives me crazy. I can't get my hands on it. But you know what? All I can do is call on God. You pray, you just keep praying to God, because God, hey, there ain't nobody fooling God. They might be fooling a lot of people, but nobody's fooling God. God sees this, and God can reveal this. And I believe that we can see greatness happen in the name of the Lord. Before he comes back, I want to see it. You want to see that? And don't you want to see all your lost family members get saved? Wouldn't that be a wonderful thing? And to go in the joy and you all get to fly away together? And wouldn't that be good? Amen. I want it. But we may see the faith that God has in this thing, but do we trust him? We have to stay focused on the truth. Isaiah 45:6-7 says this, that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west, that means from the east, from the west, and long way, that there is none beside me. I am the Lord, and there is none else. You know what? Praise his name. Praise God. He's telling you right here, there is nothing else. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man cometh unto the Father but by me. You know what? I want Jesus, and I want everybody I know. I want everybody I don't know to have Jesus. Amen. I want to lead people to Jesus. And I want this burden to fly off me onto other people, because my burden is increasing. God's working on me, and it's what I've been praying for. I want a burden for the lost. Do you have that burden? If you don't, would you pray for it? But look, the Bible says in Proverbs 16:4, "The Lord hath made all things for himself, yea, even the wicked for the day of evil." We know everybody's not getting saved. We know the Bible teaches us that straight is the gate, narrow is the way that leads unto life, and few there'll be that find it. But I believe there's going to be millions of people in heaven. Don't get me wrong, but I think there's billions of people in hell. I think every time you get these great gigantic earthquakes, you know why they're happening in the end times? Because hell's getting bigger. Because it's filling up with souls. It's filling up because people are going to hell in a handbasket. You know why? Why? It's mostly happening because Christians are sleeping. You know what? People aren't approaching God like they did 30, 40 years ago or 100 years ago. Why is that? There's too much going on. We got to get back to the basics of life. Amen? And that's trusting God. Praise God. Trusting God with our lives. Look at verse 7. It says, "Then said the sister to Pharaoh's daughter, shall I go and call thee a nurse for the Hebrews' women, that she may nurse the child for thee? And Pharaoh's daughter said, go. And the maid went and called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, that take this child away and nurse it for me, and I will give thee wages. And the woman took the child and nursed it." Now, if you study this out and you look through it, so my fifth point this morning is she was rewarded for her faith and her faithfulness in trying times. Now, not only did she get her baby back, she got to nurse her baby, and she got paid for it. Isn't that crazy? Ain't God good? Amen. You go through something and you're forcing, you're thinking, man, my beautiful baby, I don't want to throw it in the river, and so I'm going to put it in this basket. And why God put it on her heart, and I'm going to stick it in these reeds over here, and then the enemy is going to come by and see the baby, and is going to fall in love with it, get the baby, give it back to the mother, and God's going to pay her for it. Isn't that good? Isn't that good? God's good. Amen. He's so good, church. You know what? He's still working just like that. Do you believe that this morning? And I was reading this and think, praise the Lord. Let me give you a few scriptures. Listen, there is a reward. In Hebrews 11:6, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. But he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You know what? We got to get some diligent Christians walking the planet, amen, and being faithful to God. Do you believe me? He called us to do his work. Amen. Listen, Galatians 6:9, and let us not be weary in well doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. How big is your faith this morning? How much do you believe God? Do you believe God as much as Jacob did? She believed God. Praise God. What a hero of the Bible to have this much faith. Not only this, I was thinking about this. If you study, we'll read the scriptures here in just a second, but her child grew. She gave him back because that was the purpose of that child. Sometimes you got to let him go. And you think when he got old enough to understand what was going on, he went back to Pharaoh. You know, I think his mama was in his life because he knew too much about God to learn when he was over 5 years old. I think his mom was in his life all the time teaching him, and he knew. He knew when it was time. But listen, Hebrews 6:10 says, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work of labor of love, which he hath showed towards his name. And this scripture came to me this morning, James 1:12, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord have promised to them that love him. Do you love him this morning? Amen. You love him? Hey, I want my crowns. Do you want your crowns? I want mine. I want my crowns. I want something to give back to Jesus. But read verse 10 with me, and I'll be quiet this morning. It says, and the child grew, and she brought him unto Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. And she called his name Moses, and she said, because I drew him out of the water. And it came to pass in those days when Moses was grown, that he went out unto his brethren and looked on their burdens. You know what? God built Moses up to do his work. And we can contribute this today that God sent his son to look at our burdens. You know, I brought this up Wednesday night, and it touched me how much God thought, and that it was joy, that for the joy, he went to the cross. What was the joy? He could see you in heaven. He could see every Christian that believes in him in glory. You understand? The God of glory sent his son. And so he was able to go to the cross and be tortured and beaten, spit upon, not listened to. And we haven't suffered nothing, church. Not nothing what he did for us. But out of the story, how you can get out, it's the picture of Christ. That God sent his son, he saw your burden, and he saved an old wretch like me. Oh, what a savior. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. Do you have this joy? Do you have that joy? Unspeakable joy and full of glory?
Do you have that joy this morning? Hey, if you're lost, or you don't have God, or maybe you haven't been close to God lately, what are you waiting for? Now. Now's the appointed time. Now's the day of salvation. Now's the time. See, God says He'll draw all men onto Him. Some way, His Spirit has to pull people to Him. We can talk to somebody till they're blue in the face. God has to do the work. And so here, I believe God's working. He's pulling people, but you know what? He needs us to do His work. He called us to do His work. I told a guy yesterday, I said, you realize this? And he laughed at me again. I said, God can make everybody on this earth worship Him right now. All you have to do is take the oxygen out of the air and you'll be begging Him, amen? Please, Lord, your Jesus, let me breathe again. You ever seen anybody die and couldn't breathe? It's not pretty. It's a bad way to die. But God didn't. You know what He gave you? A free will. He gave you a choice, heaven or hell. Did you pick heaven this morning?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So what are we aiming towards? We definitely shouldn't be aiming towards hell. We're supposed to be aiming towards heaven. And so when we teach our children, we say, hey, we don't want to be like the devil. We want to be like Jesus. And we want to keep heading towards heaven. You know, there's too many, it's sad to say, but too many people got their face on this world. It's going to burn. Everything in it, we're not taking anything with us. It's all gone. What's our focus on? Is it on God? Is it on things of God? Is it on our Savior? Oh, what a Savior. Do you have Him this morning? Say amen.
Amen.
Let's pray. Lord, we love You and thank You, God, for Your mercy and grace and what You give us. I thank You for the story, Lord. I thank You for Jacob and their faithfulness, Lord, and how You touched her. And Lord, You accomplished Your will through her. And so I'm asking You this morning, Lord, that You would accomplish Your will through us. Each and every Christian in here, whoever is listening to this message, Lord, or any Christian that's obeying You today. Oh, You'd help us accomplish Your will, Lord. Use us, Lord. Increase our faith through these times that we're going through. And Lord, help us continue to look at You as we are living in the days of sorrows, Lord. But we're looking at this, that You're coming again, and that's our hope. Lord, we know we stand and rest on You. And Lord, I praise Your name that You've given that hope to me, and it's in my heart, and that Your Spirit lives inside of me, Lord. Thank You, God, so much for Your mercy and grace. I ask You, if there's one here today that doesn't know You, that You save them, that You would draw them, Lord. It's Your will. I pray for Your will, Lord. You work, Lord, we'll just bless You for what You do. Touch us, God. Help us do Your work. In the precious name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. As He plays this piano softly this morning, and maybe you need this altar, maybe you don't, but we have this altar open for you this morning. And maybe you're here, and maybe you got somebody in your family that needs to be prayed for. And maybe you're here, and you got somebody straying off from your family, maybe somebody away from God. And maybe you're here this morning, and like Jacob, you needed more faith. God gave her the faith she needed to accomplish the will He had for her life. Are you accomplishing the will that God has for your life? If not, ask Him. Maybe you're here this morning, you say, I've never trusted Jesus Christ, my personal Savior, and I'd like to. Would you slip up your hand and just let me pray for you? I just want to pray for you. Nobody's going to embarrass you, call you up here, won't do nothing to you. Just want you to acknowledge that there is a Savior. He loves you, and He wants to save you. He acknowledged that this morning. We praise the Lord. You're here today because we're in God's house. Pray for God to increase your faith. There a lot comes with increased faith. That means that revival will start happening in our heart. We're going to want more of God. You want more of God this morning? I want more of Him, church. I want to see more. I want to see Him working every day. Is He working in your life? Call on Him now while you can. He's good. He's faithful. Said He'd never leave us nor forsake us.